Good afternoon. My name is Jon Bartlow, and I have the pleasure of serving as the Director of Alumni and Constituent Relations at Pittsburg State University, and I'd like to welcome you to the initial episode of Pitt Pulse. This is something that we have been talking about for many months, even really over a year, and it's something that we've really wanted to do, and we've finally pulled the trigger, and we're very excited to have this show broadcasting live from the Wilkinson Alumni Center on the campus of Pittsburg State University this afternoon. I want to give special thanks to the gentleman behind the camera and at the board today, Jacob Anselmi. Jacob is the one who produces all of the amazing videos that you can see on the Pitt State YouTube channel and so many different things that we see on the Pitt State website. So I'm very appreciative of Jacob for helping us out. So why are we doing this show? Well, as the Director of Alumni Relations, a big part, and really the main part of what our office does, is bringing a piece of Pittsburg State University to you, wherever you might be. And as much as I would like to go out and meet all of our 63,000 alumni throughout the country and throughout the world, obviously that's impossible. So we said, why not put a TV show together so we can highlight the wonderful things that are going on the campus of Pittsburg State University, within our community, things having to do with our faculty, with our staff, with our students, and our community leaders. There are so many exciting things that have been going on the Pittsburg State University campus over the last several years. So we're excited finally to have a vehicle to help talk about these things and get the word out to our alumni and friends really throughout the nation and throughout the world. I wanted to take a moment and introduce myself to those of you who I have not had the pleasure of meeting and give you a little bit of background. One thing that I really want to focus on this show is not only giving you the details of the exciting projects that are going on, but I want you to really get to know the people who are behind the projects. And so I'm going to start with myself. I grew up in Kansas City, Missouri, actually graduated from Raytown High School. It had been in my future from the time I was born to be a Pitt State gorilla. I never looked at one other college or one other university. Both of my parents attended Pittsburg State University, and so I'm so excited that my college career started here and that I'm still able to be at this wonderful institution. My degree was in 1999, and I was a communication major, and my emphasis, imagine this, was broadcasting. So I worked in public radio. Thanks, guys. I worked in public radio for a few years after college, and really then haven't done any broadcasting since then. And so I'm excited to get back to my roots and excited to have a show like this. I think it's going to be very, very exciting. I got my master's degree in 2003 with a public relations emphasis. And then I left and worked at a private liberal arts college for about 3 years in student affairs. About 11 years ago, I had the amazing opportunity to come back to Pittsburg State University, come back to my alma mater, and serve as the Associate Director of Alumni Relations. I did that for a few years. I made a move over to the Office of Admission, recruited new students, worked with our admission counselors, worked with freshman orientation at Pittsburg State. And then about 3 years ago, I had the amazing opportunity to make a move back to the Office of Alumni and Constituent Relations. So it's very fitting. I worked with students as they were coming into Pittsburg State, and now I get to work with our alumni once they have left Pittsburg State University. So that's a little bit of background about me and a little bit about why we're doing this show. We're planning to do this show once a month, and we will let you know on our various media channels when the next episode will be. But the great thing is, if you're not able to catch it live, we will be archiving this show on pittstate.tv as well as the Pitt State YouTube channel. So you can always go back and catch the episodes. But we do hope many of you are tuned in live today. So today we are talking about something that I think is really one of the most exciting projects that has gone on the Pittsburg State University campus and in the community of Pittsburg in many years. So many exciting things, the Bicknell Family Center for the Arts, the Plaster Center, the expansion of the Overman Student Center. But what we're going to focus on today is the Block 22 project. And many of you who are in Pittsburgh have probably heard a lot about this over the last few months, but those of you who are outside of the Pittsburgh area might not have heard a lot about this. So what we're going to do is we're going to show you some artist renderings of what is going to be going on in downtown Pittsburgh. And then when we come back, I'm going to have Mr. Sean Naccarato here to talk to us about the Block 22 project.
Welcome to Block 22, a unique living learning community that'll be brought to life thanks to the amazing partnership between Pitt State and the City of Pittsburgh, as well as generous private gifts by PSU donors. Block 22 will combine over 100 units of student housing with more than 16,000 square feet of innovation space, all designed to help students live, learn, and innovate. So let's check out the residential units. Each unit will be a refined living area with soulful touches, including the perfect mix of historic and contemporary furnishings. Pitt State students will be able to choose between four different layouts: a standard one bedroom, spacious loft, the functional flat, and the open studio apartment. The clever integration of functional furniture and storage solutions will allow each unit to be as unique as the student living within it. See, the core idea behind Block 22 is providing students with both the perfect living space and transformational experiences. That's why Block 22 will also feature what we're calling the Foundry. Harkening back to Pittsburgh's original industrial boom, the Foundry is designed to focus the power of visionaries and create the city's next generation of entrepreneurs. The Foundry is more than a building. It's a destination for those entrepreneurial spirits that want to change the world. Block 22 is poised to be a blueprint for people around the nation. If you'd like more information, we encourage you to visit pittstate.edu/block22 and let us know if you're interested.
Well, friends, as promised, Mr. Sean Naccarato, and we hope you enjoyed those artist renderings of really the amazing renovations that are going to be going on in downtown Pittsburgh. Sean, I want to take an opportunity to let our audience know a little bit about you beyond your role here at Pittsburgh State University. I know that you're a small town guy, like many of our alumni are, and you've had a really, really great career the 10 years or so that you've been at Pitt State, and it has been about 10 years, right?
10 years in November.
Okay. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about, you know, where you started and how you ended up here at Pitt State, and what you've been doing since you graduated.
Well, so I grew up in a little town called Minden Mines, Missouri, 350 people, population 350, just barely over in the Missouri. Into Missouri. I think most people that are from this area probably know the area I'm talking about. But I sort of felt like I was destined to be a gorilla. My dad was a Pitt State alum, or is a Pitt State alum, and so it was a sort of foregone conclusion that I would cross the state line to go to college. And so,
good choice.
I agree. You know, my experience at Pittsburgh State was just so incredible. It really was that transformational experience that so many of us have, that transformational experience that we've now codified in our mission statement. But I had that experience here, and from not just in the classroom. I was a political science and history major, kind of a traditional pre-law track. But really, what was transformational for me, and it was not only the classroom, but I think what we share with probably all of Gorilla alumni is that experience of the community here. Not only the Pittsburgh community, but also the community on campus, and that sense of connectedness. That I had an opportunity to be part of rechartering a fraternity, Phi Sigs, here on campus. I was very involved in student government. Met my wife here, which is probably the most transformational thing
absolutely.
That I had. Best decision that I ever made was with her. And so when I graduated, Christy and I moved to Columbia, Missouri. I did my graduate work there, law school, JD, MPA combination. And then I worked for about 3 years for the Attorney General in Missouri. And so was a prosecutor throughout the state of Kansas, or throughout the state of Missouri, and really decided I didn't love practicing law. I missed connecting with people. That's really what I wanted to do. And this place had meant so much to me. We were about to have our second child, and my wife and I'll never forget, I was in the hallway in our home in Columbia, and I said, you know, what if there's a job at Pitt State? Wouldn't that be cool to get back closer to home? And to take what I've learned here and maybe give back to that place that meant so much to me. And so I checked the website, and there happened to be an associate general counsel job open. I applied for that. I was a finalist, had the opportunity to come back on campus, which was just a great experience to come back on campus. Didn't get the job. Again, it's one of those sort of unanswered prayers that I'm thankful for.
Absolutely.
I didn't get that job, but when they called me to say, you didn't get this job, they said, hey, there's this other job in university development. and we think you'd be would be a good fit for you. It's director of planned giving. And I said, I don't want to go beg for money. You know, it's like I'd gone to law school. Even though I didn't necessarily enjoy being a lawyer, mm-hmm. I thought, I don't really want to just, you know, jettison all that and now go do this other thing. Mm-hmm. So a good friend of mine that from law school, I'm talking to him about it one day, and this is in Columbia, and he said, what's wrong with you? I was like, what do you mean? He's like, you've got the opportunity to go home and be back home, have a great career, work for the place that you love, and advocate. It's not begging for money, it's advocating, and you advocate every day. And I realized, he said, it's about advocacy and relationship building, and that's what you care about. And I was like, you're right. So we made the decision to move back. My daughter, Nora, was born November 1st in 2007. I started my job here in November 22nd or so of 2007. And we've been back here now for almost 10 years, which is just incredible to think.
And I think one thing that speaks so highly of this institution is how many individuals who work on this campus come back to work at Pittsburg State University or even come back to live in this community. I mean, our president, Jacob Anselmi, so many individuals, and it's such a special place, and I can completely relate to your feelings about how exciting it is to get back.
Well, and I think that one thing I'm hoping, and through efforts like what you're doing here with this show, which is great, and I thank you for having me today as the first guest. It's a great honor. But is that what I hope is that folks see the experience they had there here for 4 or 6 years, however long it was, maybe they grew up here, is they start to understand how much great stuff is going on at Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
And that this is a good place to come home to. Come home to visit, come home to invest, come home to live again. And there could be opportunities, and I think that people may not realize that. So I think venues such as this can help us have those conversations.
No, absolutely. We need to get the word out, and hopefully we've got some alumni and friends who are listening right now who I think this program is really going to pique their interest, particularly the topic that we're going to talk about today.
Okay.
So, Block 22. Uh-huh. So, Sean, you wear several different hats on our campus. You worked in development. After your development position, you became the Director of Government Relations, and you worked in the President's office. You were our liaison on the national level, on the state level, and on the local level. And you had great success in that area. And then about 3 years ago, you were able to make a transition. You're still doing the government relations job, but you are now the Executive Director for the Center for Innovation and Business Development. And this is how you got involved in the Block 22 project. Okay. And I specifically remember the day that you and I were working out at the gym, and you were so excited, and you said, John, I've got to tell you about this. You know, I think there's some really great possibilities, and we've made some connections, and I can't tell you all the details on this project, but I think some really exciting things are going to be happening down the pike.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just tremendous. So can you tell us a little bit about the Block 22 project?
Yeah, it is. It's amazing. I tell you, I feel like there's a sense here that's a palpable sense of almost to explode from growth. I think that we're at that position, that tipping point, that I think someday we're going to look back and think of this era as the time that really tipped Pittsburgh back to this renaissance. And I think the Block 22 project is going to be one of those things that lights that ignites mm-hmm. that. But really, if you think about where the genesis of the Block 22 project, it's with the relationship that we had built with the city. When I had the opportunity to come into the senior leadership team, President Scott brought me into the government relations mm-hmm. role. He really said to me that he wanted to be deliberate about and intentional about our relationship building with the city of Pittsburgh. And so one of the things that we set up, that would have been 5, 6 years ago now, was a sense that we were going to be, the city and us needed to be more like a marriage than as opposed to roommates. Our destinies are shared. And so we really set out to have a strong relationship with the city. Darren Hall, Jay Byers, the folks at the city, Becky Gray, have been exceptional to work with, and so the Plaster Center wouldn't have happened without them. So all of that is a backdrop to say about, and this was October 2015, the city at that point already invested the $5 million in the Plaster Center. Mm-hmm. I get a call from Darren Hall, who in addition to being exceptional city manager, has become a good friend of mine. He says, hey, remember when we gave you $5 million for the Plaster Center? Yeah, I do. He said, we've got an opportunity that's popped up, and we would love for you just at least to entertain the conversation. Okay, well, what is it? Well, what would you think about some student housing downtown? And it's like, oh, I don't know. You know, it's not necessarily within our direct scope of plans. But I talked to Dr. Irwin, our Vice President for Student Affairs, and I said, let's go down and visit with him. We at least owe him that. And we visit with them, and it's, you know, I use this term a lot. You've heard me use it, the strategic serendipity term. And this is a great example of that. Becky Gray had been in a housing conference. She ran into a housing development group called the Vecino Group, mm-hmm. who had just hired a guy named Matt Burton. Matt Burton had been, it was a Pitt State grad. He was the student body president, had been the president of SIFE, now inactive, and had that great experience, had grown up here, graduated from St. Mary's Colgan. He had gone off for a while and he'd come back to Springfield and was working for this group called the Vecino Group. But for him working with that group, I don't know that this whole project would have happened. And so the buildings, of course, that we're talking about, so that everybody knows what we're talking about, are the first four commercial buildings in the history of Pittsburgh. They're at the corner of 4th and Broadway. Most of the viewers will remember them as the Kroll Building, the National Bank Building. And then there's two other buildings that aren't necessarily usually as known. One is called the Opera House Hotel, which is just north of the National Bank Building. You see it there on the left, the darker colored building. And then there's a small building in between the Colonial Fox Theater and the Kroll Building that's called the Baxter Building. These buildings were, again, the first four commercial buildings built in the history of Pittsburgh. And the city has been for, you know, they've been unfortunately going through some significant decline in the last couple generations. Mm-hmm. The city had been trying to figure out how we're going to redevelop this. They could not find a developer to do it. They run across this Vecino group who had hired a guy who happened to be a Pitt State guy, and started talking about what if we could put some student housing down there. So we entered an agreement with the developer to explore it. And at the time, initially, we thought, okay, this probably is not going to work financially, you know. But Matt Burton and I worked really closely together last year and started to think of, well, what could, as opposed to just being housing, what could we turn this into? And because that had been the commercial center of Pittsburgh and the commercial founding of Pittsburgh, we started to come up with this notion of how could this connect with some of the innovation entrepreneurship work we're doing. So we said, we started to conceptualize this notion of a living learning community where you have students that are in areas of art, commerce, and technology could live and learn in the same position, place. So they can live there, and then we have space that's going to be dedicated for business incubation, co-working space, collision space, as we like to call it, places that will facilitate discussions and idea generation. But then also a big chunk of my team in the Center for Innovation and Business Development is moving downtown. Yeah. So, you know, I don't know a better expression of when we say transformational experiences for our students and our community than really will be personified in the Block 22 project. It really is us bringing our services, our students downtown Pittsburgh to revitalize and help to prompt a renaissance in Pittsburgh, Kansas, and I couldn't be more excited about having an opportunity to be a part of it.
Yeah, it's incredibly exciting. Where did the name Block 22 come from?
Yeah, so that's usually the second most asked question. First being,
what's the first most asked?
Where's everybody going to park? That's the one that most people.
But we've got that figured out. Right?
We are figuring that out. We have it figured out. We know there's going to be places for people to park. Let's not talk about parking just yet. Let's talk about the name first.
Okay.
I think that you probably, the folks are seeing this image of a map of Pittsburgh. This is an early map of Pittsburgh showing how, when originally it was platted, there was, I think it was 50 some odd blocks that were platted. So when the city founders decided to incorporate, make a city, went to the county to say, hey, we want to make a city in Pittsburgh, they had platted out these 50 some odd platted blocks. Well, if you'll notice at 4th and Broadway, the block number there was 22. And so part of the naming is about a hearkening to the past, an honoring of the past, this immigrant heritage that we have, this hardworking grit and determination that built this place, that we don't want to lose that. And so some of it is honoring that past and also fulfilling the promise of that past. Another picture that I love that we've used in many of our presentations that I think the viewers are seeing now is this picture of us. This is a streetscape picture in the early 1900s on downtown Pittsburgh, Kansas. And there's so much about this picture that I love. There's also so much of that captures what we're trying to fulfill and the promise. You know, it says, push Pittsburgh past 50,000.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this was in 1916, I believe, 1914, 1916, somewhere in that neighborhood. And the population, what do you think the population of Pittsburgh was then?
I bet it was about the same as it is now.
It was. It was 20,000,
mm-hmm.
And it was bustling, and it was booming, and there was this sense of promise and opportunity. And I know you have a similar immigrant story that I do.
Yes, exactly.
We're rooted
here in this area.
Right. Mm-hmm. My great-grandfather and your great-grandfather mm-hmm. Both sailed across an ocean to get to a land of promise that was Pittsburgh, or in my case it was Weir City, Kansas, mm-hmm. where my great-grandfather came. There was a sense of opportunity and promise and hopefulness that you saw in that picture. It's colorful. It's bustling. There's this sense of vibrancy. And there also is that you can almost feel that sense in these folks that are standing there, that even if they have very difficult jobs and they're digging into the ground, that they feel confident that the life of their children is going to be better than theirs because of their decision to take that chance. And so what really animates me, and that, so I think about my great-grandfather, and it's sort of almost like the passing the torch or that baton of my responsibility to keep this a place that people want to and are willing to cross an ocean to take the chance on. But then also this sort of sense of, for my own kids, and this is even in a small sense, as I think about Jude and Nora, I think I don't want them to ever feel as if they're stuck in Pittsburgh.
Right.
But I want them to have an opportunity to choose to stay here or to come back here and to continue to call it home and it be a place that's thriving and it continues to be a place of opportunity. And not only that, but also that we're creating ladders of opportunity for every child in Southeast Kansas, no matter the zip code that they're born in, no matter the school that they're in, no matter the circumstances for their home life, that if they're talented, if they work hard, that we help them to be that ladder that helps them toward that star that they're trying to reach.
And you know, I would say to our alumni and friends who are watching right now, if you have not been back to Pittsburgh in a few years, if you have not been back to this campus for a few years, things have changed. And things are very different than they were when you and I were in college in the mid and late 90s. I mean, I thought Pittsburgh was a pretty great place then, but it is many, many times better, a better community, and I just think an overall better place to live than it was, and that is because of the forward thinking of and the relationship that Pittsburgh State University has built with our community. You know, that relationship has been recognized on a national level, hasn't it? Could you talk just briefly about that? Because I think that's really exciting.
Yeah, there's an organization, it's called the International Town Gown Association, and it's kind of a strangely named organization, I think, you know, for many. Town Gown basically is a shorthand for university-city relationships. Mm-hmm. So cities that have a university are part of this organization called International Town Gown Association. And yes, our work it's interesting. I would say that if I were to point to what our biggest successes are, I mean, the Plaster Center mm-hmm. would be the number one, shortly now to be somewhat maybe surpassed by Block 22 once it's completed. But you think these big things have happened. What we ended up being honored for nationally was actually our work in a land exchange, which is it seems like it's a really wonky sort of thing. And it's not that that didn't take work, but it's amazing. I think it also is emblematic of how difficult it is to accomplish these sorts of things. Uh-huh. How it is not the default position that a university and a city will get along well. And so that we were honored at the International Town and Gown Association for our work in, there was a out by, some people, I'm trying to think of a reference point, where the Baja occurs.
Yes.
There's land, the city owned the land that was on the frontage, and we owned the land that was basically behind the frontage and then up. We kind of had a sense of we kind of owned the wrong land. The city knew they needed more housing development. Mm-hmm. We wanted to have access from the road and have that frontage. And so we ended up working out a swap that sounds like, well, what's the big deal? But the challenge is when you are exchanging state property and all those kind of things. And so we had to go through the legislature and we did some things on that. We were able to accomplish it. But what I think it really, and what we are honored, what I like to think that we were being recognized for, is the level of joint planning that we now have. Mm-hmm. You know, because you're having, I know you're serving this year on our Joint City University Advisory Board, which is it's a codified, recognized organization that's a joint organization of leaders from the university and from the city who we get together every month to talk about what issues are going on in areas of economic development, student initiatives, land use planning, mm-hmm. all those sorts of things. We are coordinating, and I think what the recognition is that in a community our size, in a place that has the challenges that we have from a socioeconomic standpoint, we can't afford silos. Mm-hmm. And we can't afford silos internally or externally. And so I think that what we're seeing is that now we're doing this master planning. We now, and I don't know of any other institution in the country that has this relationship or this arrangement, as of January 1st, we now are helping to lead economic development for the city of Pittsburgh. So the Center for Innovation Business Development has a contract with the city of Pittsburgh to work alongside the Chamber of Commerce to do that, to run economic development. So it also plays into this, what we're doing on campus right now. Block 22 plays into this broader, what we're kind of phrasing, innovation constellation. Mm-hmm. And what we're trying to accomplish with that is to connect existing or emerging resources that the university has, connect them in such a way that they're networked so that they can help to facilitate and expedite innovation, entrepreneurship, and support business growth. I think that innovation constellation and what we're doing, one piece of that is the Tyler Research Center and the polymer work that we're doing. Adjacent to the Tyler Research Center is the eventually planned development of a research and development park, seven acres there. And through all of that planning, it really helped us to link up, not only us to link up internally some things that need to be linked to help facilitate that innovation and entrepreneurship, but then I think also it helped because the city then saw that that made even more sense for them to plug into that too. And so the place where the city plugs into that from a hub and spoke standpoint is Block 22. And so when you look at, if you think about the things that will be on the door at Block 22, it includes, it will be the home of economic development for the city of Pittsburgh. And not only the city of Pittsburgh, for the entire region.
It's incredible. It's incredible. So Block 22 project, where are we in this project, Sean? Wasn't there kind of a milestone here in the last few weeks?
There was a big milestone. We actually just closed officially St. Patrick's Day. This is kind of wild, and I talk about this strategic serendipity, and I'm a big believer in there not being any coincidences, and sometimes it's a little bit, this is a little eerie kind of coincidence, but it closed on 3/17/17, it was St. Patrick's Day. No joke, the last email finalized and everything was at 3/17. 3/17 on 3/17/17, and so I'm not saying I'm a big numerologist or anything, but I would say that that project has been filled with just some incredible, it feels as if there's something bigger at work in what it's helping to propel from the community. I think the video folks are seeing right now was an exciting day. That was another one of our milestones. That was just before the closing. We signed the lease with the development company for us to have the master lease arrangement, and that was a big day. It's amazing the amount of work, the amount of legal minds that were involved.
So many moving parts to this project, and so many people have worked. I was so hard on it.
Yeah, and I tell you, we've been so fortunate. The developer, Vecino, Matt Burton, have been so incredible to work with. They've been so in the city. The city was the first investor. They put $1.5 million into that project. They put $1.5 million in the Block 22 project. And the developer helped us to identify tax credits that we didn't know that we could even. Some of the tax credits that we're using have never been used in rural Kansas, in the history of Kansas. It's incredible. And I was just talking with the developer this week, and he said that he was talking to one of the multitude of attorneys that was involved in this project throughout the country. And he was in Chicago or Wisconsin, and he's done a lot of these deals. He said this is the second most complicated deal he had been involved in. And this is in little Pittsburgh, Kansas, right? It was little Pittsburgh, Kansas.
Big things happening in Pittsburgh, Kansas.
There's so many big things. Next week, John, we are hosting the Global Manufacturing Summit on this campus next Thursday. The Department of Commerce, we've been working with them. We're hosting the Global Manufacturing Summit for Kansas, April 6th. We are sold out.
How many people are coming?
More than 200. And these are executive level folks from manufacturers, not just in Kansas, from throughout the country and some internationally, are coming to Pittsburgh, Kansas. And what our hope is that, and I think what we're showing in this, is that this could be the permanent home for an annual global manufacturing summit for the state of Kansas that pulls in, because anyone who has been in, even if you weren't a technology major, if you've been through the College of Technology and you know anything about that kind of thing, it is a place that is unique and unlike any other. Under one roof to have all those things. And when the Secretary of Commerce, Antonio Suave, took a tour of the place, he had never been in it. He's originally from Detroit. He had never been in it. He had been involved in international business deals. He goes to this facility and he's like, I've never seen anything like this. So he's now in his, you'll hear him when he's out talking, he'll say, if you want to go to a place that supports manufacturing, you either go to Purdue or Pittsburgh State University. And so it's unbelievable.
That's absolutely great. So you're doing many, many different things under the roof of the Center for Innovation and Business Development. And I know you have worked quite closely with the Kansas Polymer Research Center as well, and there are some exciting things that are going on with that. Do you mind just briefly talking about that as well?
Oh, yeah. One of the things, one of the responsibilities and charges that I have is to help us to, from an innovation standpoint, identify how we set up and be more efficient in technology transfer. And what that means is basically using research that we're doing here and getting it into the marketplace. And So the Kansas Palm Research Center is sort of the tip of the spear on that. It's at Kansas Palm Research Center, for those who aren't familiar with it, it was originally founded in the early 90s. It's been housed in the Tyler Research Facility, which is a world-class research facility on the campus of Pittsburg State University since 2007. It's been housed there when the building opened. We have an exceptional group of scientists there who are dedicated to industrially relevant polymer research. And so polymers are basically plastics, but it's plastics, coatings, elastomers, those sort of thing. And it ties in so well with our plastics engineering technology program in the College of Technology, as well as our chemistry program, which has a polymer chemistry bachelor's and master's degree programs, which were just developed. In fact, in 2012 that those were launched. We had the Kansas Polymer Research Center, and we got funding. We convinced the legislature to give us funding, $1 million a year, to start a new academic program in polymer chemistry where we were training students in polymer chemistry so that they could not only have the science but understand the application of it. And so the Kansas Polymer Research Center is sort of the linchpin of that whole thing. And there's such incredible work going on there. Just yesterday we had an exciting announcement. We publicly announced an agreement with Honeywell Corporation, which is, of course, as you know, in Kansas City. Most people will know the name Honeywell.
Absolutely.
It's exciting. We've done some projects with Honeywell over the last few years. And now we announced this new broad agreement, which will help to facilitate future projects and partnership. And Honeywell is an example of one of those kind of companies that we can help to be an anchor. In the past, we've worked with Cargill. That's one of those other, has been an anchor in the past, where we developed some bio-based soy materials with them. But this arrangement with Honeywell, I think, is very promising. In fact, actually, as we speak, they're probably wrapping up. They did a full day, about 10 or 12 of their science and technical folks from Honeywell, about 10 to 12 of our science and research folks doing an idea exchange, spending the whole day doing that. And so that's the kind of exciting things that we're making happen here at Pittsburgh State.
No, it's very, very exciting. And the thing that I don't know if everybody realizes this, but the things that are going on the campus of Pittsburgh State University, a Division II institution, that's not happening in other D2 schools. And it's not happening at a lot of Division I schools.
Yeah.
So we're incredibly blessed.
Oh, we're so blessed. And I think actually we keep alluding to it, but the community support, the relationship with the city, we can't take that for granted.
No.
And I think part of the reason why this is a different place than it was 10 years ago, mm-hmm. that you acknowledged, when I have people come back here that have been gone, if they've been gone more than 10 years, they come here, it looks like it's dramatically different. There's a big contrast. I think it's because we quit taking for granted that relationship with the city. I think there was some period of time between Russ Hall burning down, the city helping us rebuild it, and 10 years ago, that I think that we probably got a little bit lackadaisical about our relationship and how important it is to maintain that at all times. We're very deliberate about it now, and I think that it really shows, and you're seeing just such a feeling of momentum. And I just would really encourage folks to come home for a football game, come home for a basketball game, come home just to come home for the weekend, see what's going on. There's so much to do here, there's so much to see here. And hopefully people will start to see that there's opportunities for them for not only to come home to visit, but to come home to live again and raise their families.
Absolutely. And hey, there are more hotels for them to stay in when they
there
come
are
home now, too.
As of Friday, we had additional 100 and some beds at the Hampton Inn.
So. Yeah, so that was needed and something that we're very excited about as well.
Very much
so
needed.
You talked a little bit about the Kansas Polymer Research Center and as well as the relationship that it has with the Plastics Engineering Technology Department. And we just happen to have a clip here today that Jacob has put together of a young lady at Pittsburgh State who has really landed a dream job. And so if we could go ahead and roll that, we would really love to share that with you.
Plastics really became my passion because I just think there's such a broad future for plastics. We talk about the bioplastics, we talk about silicones or any kind of new forming synthesized plastic. There's so many options. Plastics was introduced to me in high school. I kind of began to understand that a lot of people blame plastics for a lot of the world's problems. And it's not bad plastic, it's bad application. And so just being able to take that and use my knowledge to further educate people and give plastics a better name. Pittsburgh State, the program, the lab time is just crucial, because you can read all you want in the book and look everything up on YouTube, but if you don't get in and you don't get your hands on the machines, you're really not going to understand the concepts and be able to apply it.
Another example of the transformational experiences that are happening on campus at Pittsburgh State University right there. So, this incredibly exciting thing's going on. Before we close here in just a few moments, I want to toss it back over to Sean Naccarato. There's a groundbreaking going on coming
there
up
is.
Pretty soon.
We're actually not certain if we should call it a groundbreaking or a wall breaking.
Right.
I don't know exactly what the term is for this, but when you're renovating and transforming the these four historic buildings, I don't know if you call the start of construction a groundbreaking or not. I think the groundbreaking was 1896, but we're doing the re-groundbreaking.
Right.
And that's April 25th, 11 a.m. We're going to actually be doing that in the historic Colonial Fox Theater.
And that's very fitting because of what is going on in downtown Pittsburgh.
It is, and it also is very fitting and I think embracing of this notion of, as I said, we really want that corner, that intersection, that place has always been about art, commerce, and technology. And so if we can, we're going to host that groundbreaking, wall-breaking ceremony to commemorate the start of reconstruction, the start of our renaissance, at the Colonial Fox Theater on April 25th at 11 a.m. And I also would encourage folks, just a little plug for the Center for Innovation and Business Development, the kind of services that we have to offer there. You don't have to be a student, you can be a community member, but we offer support for if you have an idea, for entrepreneurship, taking it from idea to successful implementation, small business counseling, helping to identify financing, all those sorts of things from a business standpoint. If you have an idea, we want to help you to achieve your dreams and to implement those ideas. And so you can follow us on Twitter, see our website, and again, we're going to be moving our operation downtown Pittsburgh so that we can be more accessible to our community.
When will that happen, Sean?
That'll happen. You were asking me about timeline earlier, and we got kind of distracted. But we're under construction for the next 16 months.
Okay.
We got about 2 months of demolition, and then they'll start rebuilding. Right now, we're looking at an August 2018 open. Okay. And so that will be when folks can actually come in and start enjoying Block 22.
It'll be here before we know it.
Before we know it.
And people can stay updated about the progress of the Block 22 project by checking out those
those social media sites.
Okay.
and watching, following us on following Block 22 on Twitter. Our Block 22 Twitter account will have updates. We're gonna try to keep frequent communication with regard to how the construction is progressing there. And then any of the more broad innovation and business development sort of things, you can follow us at CIBD.
Outstanding. Well, everybody, Sean Naccarato. Sean, thanks a lot for being here with us this afternoon for this inaugural show.
Yeah.
I'm excited about this show. I'm excited about what it's going to bring in the future. And we would certainly welcome your comments. We'd like to know, what would you like to know more about? What are you interested in at Pitt State? And my hope is that this show is really going to pique your interest in many of the exciting things going on our campus. I would imagine there are probably things that have been going on that you're not even aware of, and that's why we are doing this. A great way to stay in touch with us, we would invite you to connect with us on our Facebook page, to connect with us on Twitter. Also, Jacob Anselmi is such a talented guy. He, with the help of Brett Dalton and many other talented individuals in the Office of Marketing and Communication, put together wonderful informational videos and things that really can help you see what's going on the Pittsburgh State University campus as well. So check those out. Check out our YouTube page. Please like our Facebook page. Let us know what you think about Pitt Pulse. And thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. I would like to say, too, if you liked what you saw today, share this with your friends. Share it with your fellow alumni. And we would love to help get the word out there about Pitt Pulse. We will see you again coming up in just about a month. Stay tuned to social media and the Pitt State website, and we will make sure and let you know as soon as possible when the next episode is going to be and who the guest will be that day. So thanks again to Sean Naccarato. Thank you to our producer, Jacob Anselmi, and everyone else who helped. And we will go ahead and take it out. Everybody, have an absolutely wonderful day, and don't forget, once a gorilla, always a gorilla.